BioBalance HealthCast episode 256, Symptoms of PTSD.
BioBalance HealthCast features conversations about positive aging. Your hosts are Dr. Kathy Maupin, Medical Director of BioBalance Health and a leading expert in treating symptoms of aging, and Brett Newcomb, a licensed professional counselor.
Today we're going to talk about PTSD, which is a subject that Brett Newcomb is an expert in. So I am going to pick his brain today about this condition, and it's post-traumatic stress disorder. Mm-hmm. And that has to do with people undergoing a lot of stress, a lot of trauma, and what the outcome is symptomatic, and he's going to tell us the symptoms and how we treat it. It's a more psychological, psychiatric diagnosis, yet it does have a basis in physiology.
Well, and that's the thing. We're going to do two conversations. One today, just sort of explore the concept of PTSD and where the term came from and what it looks like, who is exposed or gets it, how you get diagnosed, those kind of things. But what is beginning to show up in the research is evidence about changes in brain chemistry. Mm-hmm. And so when we get to that part, that's where you come in with
that's
what you know, to talk about adrenaline and cortisol and dopamine and serotonin and the SSRIs and all of those kind of things, mm-hmm, that are used to complement the treatment. It's a complex set of problems. The term PTSD was originally developed in 1980 to be included in the DSM-3.
Which is?
The DSM is the Diagnostic and Statistical Manual of the American Psychiatric Association, and it is the codex for describing the requirements to have any kind of diagnostic label for mental health disorder.
Like, if you're not in there, you're not a disease.
Yeah, exactly. But so, it explains, like, for someone like me as a therapist to be able to say that someone like you suffers from a panic attack or an anxiety disorder or multiple personality is now called dissociative identity disorder. Yeah, well, you don't, but your other parts do. To be able to say that with any sort of clinical professionalism implies that other clinicians in other parts of the country, say if you moved away and, mm-hmm, and said, send for my records, that they would have an understanding of what I saw, what I was thinking, what I was trying to do with you, that would help them pick up the pieces and move on.
And without a 20-page expose.
Exactly. So PTSD was included in panic attacks and stress-related disorders in 1980. And it was defined, and from 1980 to today, it's been revised any number of times. Mm-hmm. Most recent revision was 2013 for the DSM-5. They keep updating those just like they do the ICD.
Yeah, the codes that we use for diagnoses.
For medical disorders.
For medical disorders, but it is a medical disorder.
Yes.
It's in the ICD-10 now.
Yes.
Book, but the DSM is just for psychiatric.
Well, psychiatric, psychological, mental, mm-hmm, health,
right.
And so we have to look in those. And so in the revision, the DSM-5, it's been separated into its own category. And so you have two or three clusters of similar disorders that are identified that have their own sets of, mm-hmm, symptoms that are subsets or parallels to PTSD. Mm-hmm. So it's moved from anxiety disorders into its own grouping now, mm-hmm, in part because there's concern about how many soldiers are coming back from the war that are going to have PTSD experiences as a result of what they saw in the war. Mm-hmm. You have to personally have experienced a traumatic event that causes certain changes within you as a result of that exposure. Mm-hmm. Things like numbing or dissociative process. Dissociative process, lights are on, nobody's home. You go away somewhere. People that have experienced severe trauma, violent sexual assault, see somebody die, be in a car wreck where the train that went off the tracks in New England a couple weeks ago, all the bodies scattered around the place. Those are not things most of us ever experience, thank God.
Personally.
And when you do experience them, mm-hmm, they can have a traumatic impact on you. And, mm-hmm, part of what you'll talk about next week is what happens to the brain when the body is hyper-aroused and in a panic fight-or-flight mode, mm-hmm, what happens to the brain and the body chemistry that can actually now, it's believed, be what we call one trial learning, that you associate certain trigger events, certain surrounding circumstances, and whenever you re-experience one of those, you hear a sound, you smell a smell, you flash back to that moment, and you actually lose touch with reality.
And it's terrifying.
Present reality.
No matter where you are, no matter what you're doing, it's terrifying. It intrudes in your life. It pushes into your life. And this is something that I know, not personally, but from my patients. And I have a lot of patients who see me for hormonal problems who have also PTSD. And they intertwine. And we deal with them a little differently in terms of how we replace their hormones. But PTSD for them may have been a rape.
Yes.
May have been...
Oh, absolutely. Parental abuse.
Child abuse. May have been being beaten, or emotional abuse or neglect. But neglect
or
in a way...
Or see your mother get beaten.
Or your mother leaves.
Yeah.
You know, and your mother leaves and you remember that day over and over again and it comes back to you. And it comes back in nightmares and it comes back in all types of feelings. And those... especially with the trigger. Mm-hmm. You smell her cologne, boom. So it changes how you think. This is an all-encompassing diagnosis. It is not just a little anxiety here and then the rest of your life's okay.
No. No, and so there are four clusters of symptoms that people show, and you have to show some manifestation in each of the symptom clusters. Mm-hmm. And so you have intrusions, intrusive thoughts, which are like flashbacks. Something will trigger. I've worked with clients who have sexual abuse histories who will find that around the anniversary of their sexual abuse, or if they have a child who is now the age that they were when they were abused, that they start waking up at 3 o'clock in the morning, every single morning, in a panic attack, in a sweat, hyperventilating, terrified because they had a sense in their dream that something bad was happening. And then as we process that and try to help resolve that so they're not having those panic attacks at 3 o'clock in the morning, what we often find is that is the time that grandpa used to come into their bedroom and rape them. And so because they have a child that in their unconscious is the same vulnerability, the same age, the same process.
But
Grandpa's not there. But their brain is flashing back. And so with PTSD, you have those intrusive experiences where something flashes and freezes. Anybody that watches TV sees this in shows and movies all the time. They do the cutaways to that kind of stuff. You have avoidance, which is a set of symptoms about how you numb out emotionally. You shut down. Your face becomes still. You literally, I say, lights are on, nobody's home.
Right, you
people
look like
go away.
You're not there.
And in therapy, this is one of the first presenting symptoms that I start to recognize. We'll be talking about something, and I will see somebody shift. And often there's like an eye movement, you know, switch to the left or something that triggers for me, or they cross their legs or uncross their legs or move their hands in a disjointed way from their normal conversational flow, and I will interrupt them and say, I just saw something happen that I don't understand. What are you aware of? Can you tell me about that? And invariably, they will say, nothing happened. I don't know what you're talking about. But over time, they start to recognize.
I watched the movie, The Girl with the
Dragon Tattoo.
Yeah. And she did
that.
She
had that. A lot of PTSD.
She had a ton
it was all
of
about PTSD.
PTSD.
Yeah.
And she would just sit there. And she'd have this. She'd do the, no emotion. People could be saying anything, and she'd be like, nothing.
Well, and they
totally
could disappear
nothing.
In a crowd, or in a conversation, or at the checkout lane at the grocery store. They're making change, and suddenly they just sort of freeze. And
it's an immobilization.
It's like time out. Yeah, and then they switch back, and they get their change, and they go on.
So we're telling you this because we want you to think. Is this happening to a loved one? Is this happening to you? If this is, then you know, you need to talk about it because this is something you need to talk about with a professional.
Well, and there are two more clusters of equally important
symptoms. No one else knows how to do this. Okay, I'm sorry.
The third one is negative alterations in thinking and mood. And that typically comes out as, I am bad, it's my fault. You know, you have survivor guilt. You know, everybody in the family was killed in the wreck. I was driving, it's my fault. I'm a horrible person.
Even if it wasn't.
Even if it wasn't. And even if it's been proven factually it wasn't your fault, they still feel that way. So survivor guilt can be a problem. And for some of these soldiers coming back, I'm the only one that survived that explosion. And mm-hmm. my Bradley vehicle was blown up and everybody died but me, and I should have died with them.
Everybody should look at this in movies. There's a lot of this in movies now.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
And PTSD, I want people to know that PTSD is not a new phenomenon.
No.
It's a new name for a phenomenon
we've seen yeah.
forever, after World War I, after World War II, after huge disasters.
Where I first
disasters.
Started hearing about it was soldiers coming back in Vietnam because there was mm-hmm. no transition
right.
from the battlefield. And in World War I, World War II, you had months after combat was over before these guys started coming home. So they mm-hmm. had some deprocessing and debriefing time. Mm-hmm. In Vietnam, they pull these soldiers out of the jungle, literally put them on a plane, ship them to San Francisco, and 28, 30 hours after being on patrol in the jungle with people shooting at them, they're walking down the street in San Francisco.
I didn't know that. I wasn't really aware what was going on.
You know, at different cycles in the war, which went on about 10 years, more and more animosity was civically focused on the soldiers, and they were called baby killers and things like
right.
that.
Right. I mean, it was such a
traumatic and
terrible.
But to be out of months of hypervigilant combat and then hear a backfire. You know, mm-hmm. you're on the ground, covering up, and without yes. thinking, it's a reflex, but it's a life-saving reflex. But you're in the middle of the zoo in San Francisco, mm-hmm. and people are looking at you, like, what the hell's wrong with you?
But you're really in the jungle.
You're back there. You break out in a sweat. And so that leads me to the fourth syndrome, alterations in arousal and reactivity.
And arousal doesn't mean sexual arousal.
No, it means hypervigilance. You're cued, you're alert for incoming danger from mm-hmm. any sign. And all your senses are on hyper status, sight, sound, movement, fast, jerk, twitch, mm-hmm. all those things happen. So when you get somebody that's showing these four cluster symptoms, mm-hmm. then you're looking at somebody that probably has PTSD.
And what would they do if they found that, oh, that's what's wrong with my kid.
Yeah.
Or that's what's wrong with my mom.
Well, if you're listening to this and you know somebody that, or you're having some of these symptoms, what I would say is what Kathy just said, get to a professional. Go to somebody and say, I've had so many people come in, I think I'm crazy. You've had the same thing.
Mm-hmm.
I have these experiences. I have this happen to me. I don't, and nothing ever happened. Well, their memory is blocked because
right.
your unconscious defense mechanisms protect you. And dissociation is an extreme end example of the basic defense of repression. Repression is when your mind blocks your awareness of things that are too painful or too uncomfortable for you to afford to remember.
Mm-hmm.
And as you get mentally healthier and stronger, you can afford more readily mm-hmm. to remember these things. And that's often when, and it's a timing cue, when you start having these flashbacks, the stimulus in your environment is so similar that mm-hmm. you're still having some trauma experiences.
Mm-hmm.
There's stuff going on, like a first responder. The siren goes off, and you go into numb mode and go function.
And the phone goes off
in
the middle of the night.
All around you, and you still function. Mm-hmm. Or, B, you're now getting strong enough psychologically that you can remember and process and deal with these traumatic experiences so that you can get healthy, that you can break the grip mm-hmm. that they have on you. So that would be the goal.
Okay.
So if you or a loved one has this and you go to a professional, they're going to recommend a protocol of treatment. And one of the elements of the protocol we're going to speak about more expansively next week is medicine. There are a number of different medicines, and a lot of them are the basic antidepressants mm-hmm. to just sort of put a floor and a ceiling under the hypervigilance reaction of your body.
They use anti-anxiety for the hyper.
Yes.
And then for the depression.
Yeah.
Because, of course, you have to, I mean, if you have this happen all the time, that uses up your serotonin. And so you get depressed. And so oftentimes you use a doctor would give you an anti-anxiety and an antidepressant.
Well, and most of the antidepressants have a small amount of mm-hmm. anti-anxiety in them mm-hmm. as well. Yeah. So
you depends on how bad you are.
So and the level of the dose. So they will recommend. Typically, they'll recommend that you go to a physician, if you go see a counselor,
mm-hmm.
If you go see a psychiatrist, he is mm-hmm. a physician, and they'll recommend that you get on some medicine to help stabilize your symptomatic reactivity.
Mm-hmm.
Then they will start trying a program of therapy And ideally, your therapist should explain to you, this is how I think this works. This is what I tend to do. This is the data that supports my approach. But there are half a dozen approaches. One is what's called EMDR. It's eye movement desensitization and reprogramming of thoughts. Mm-hmm. And so they teach you, they try to get you in touch with your traumatic memory. They get you to go back. It's not a hypnosis thing. It's a voluntary thing. But they try to get you to remember as much of it as you can. And while that's working, they're making a little movement with their pen or their hand, and your eyes are supposed to be tracking, and they talk that through with you. Mm-hmm. And the belief is that that can help retrain that one trial learning of the adrenaline mm-hmm. flood that comes. Mm-hmm. So that's one methodology. It's a controversial one. A lot of people say, oh, my God, it's the best thing since sliced bread. And others say it's the hokey pokey. You know, it's pay your money, take your choice.
Well, it's probably working for some people and not for others. And so that means, but there's always, if you have two paths and you have a population, some people will respond to one thing and some will respond to another.
And that's the whole point that I was going to make. If you ever are in a position where you or a loved one needs to go to a therapist, for best results, you need to have a relationship of trust with that therapist. You need to have a sense that I like this person, they can hear me, they can help me, I feel better. If that feels creepy, icky, whatever, I would recommend go to somebody else. Mm-hmm. It's not that the therapy doesn't work, it's that that therapist isn't any good. Mm-hmm. It's that this connection isn't established. And so you're not ever going to be safe enough to open up as much as you would need to open up so that I could be in a position to help you. So
critical.
I would tell people
the
all the time,
relationship.
You know what? You come in and you see, because they call me, say, well, what do you charge? And I insurance, blah, blah, blah. And I would say, come in and talk to me. If you feel good at the end of the hour and you want to come back, pay me for the hour. If you don't pay me. Go somewhere else. It's not about making every dollar come in the door that mm-hmm. you can get. It's about making a good match so that you can do good mm-hmm. therapy and help people. So another approach is what's called cognitive behavioral therapy. And in cognitive behavioral therapy, or CBT, or DBT, there's another, they're all
they got
alphabet
letters for everything.
but they basically try to teach you to think differently, to reality test your experience. You know, I was terrified of snakes as a child, and also dead bodies. I couldn't go to funerals. I'd have panic attacks.
Are you talking about yourself?
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
I really was.
I didn't know that.
And I'm not now, but I've had some work on those things.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, I can hold a snake now. I can touch a snake now. I don't like it. I don't want to. My body still screams, but I can do it. Mm-hmm. I used to freeze. I used to have a panic attack in the presence of a snake. And my oldest son used to torture me. He'd always want to go to the snake house at the zoo, and I could never go in. And he'd laugh at me and make fun of me. And I'd be standing outside waiting for him to come out because I'm not going there. Now I can do it. I don't like it. But you can work through some of those things. So cognitive behavioral therapy can help you figure out how to think about it, and then it blends into some of these others. None of these are pure art forms. Another one is relaxation therapy. Your body instinctively, reactively gets aroused, and mm-hmm. you learn the triggers. You learn the triggers. You learn to recognize what this means. It doesn't mean I'm in danger. It means I'm having a flashback.
Mm-hmm.
So let's look around. Is there danger? But let's look around, not in a hypervigilant panic mode, you know, fight or flight.
Mm-hmm.
Let's look around and say, what in my environment is causing me? Is it that smell? What is that smell?
Mm-hmm.
And can I learn to identify that smell differently so that I don't have the same reaction? Is it that sound? Is it that look in your eye? You know, I've talked to little girls, grown women in their 40s who remember when grandpa would get a certain look on his face. Or would say certain cue words, and it would cause them to just go away somewhere. And the sexual relationships between a sexual abuse survivor and their husband, there's a great book by Ken Graber called Ghosts in the Bedroom. If you are in a relationship with a woman or a man that's a sexual abuse survivor, that's going to impact your sexual relations with your partner in the most negative of ways. And neither of you is at fault for that, but there's something you have to understand. And so therapy can help with that because mm-hmm. both of you have to learn to recognize the triggers. There may be something in the way that you approach her one time and that sets her off in a panic attack, and other times things are great and you don't know which, and you don't know how to understand it. And those are learnable things mm-hmm. and treatable things.
That's
so
good.
You can do relaxation therapy, eye movements, cognitive behavioral therapy, classic talk therapy, group therapy. All of these things are ways that we have a lot of data to support that can help this population get better. But the goal is to stop the traumatic reaction to the past event so that that thing or those things that you experience no longer control and regulate your body's reactivity, your mental processing, and your emotional regulation, so that you can live a calmer, happier, more productive life without the burden of carrying that trauma through your generation and your life.
Because it affects everyone around you, too.
And the way you raise your children, what you teach them, you know, stranger danger, all those kind of things that people get concerned about. And my personal psychological or clinical history has been more, and I've done a lot of PTSD work and dissociative identity work, and it's mostly about childhood abuse and sexual abuse. But the focus right now, I mean, we're in the political silly season, and all the politicians are running, and they all have things to say about the wars and the VA and the treatment and Obamacare and all that. We have so many soldiers who have, men and women both, and their families, who have experienced repetitive trauma after four, five, six rotations into the war zone, and no real debriefing or reprocessing or re-energizing, and no real understanding of the changes. That population is going to be at a crisis level for the next 20 years. So clinicians need to know about this and need to know how to treat it, but so do family members, so do you. If you or one of your loved one manifests this symptomology, please get them to a therapist. Please understand that this is a treatable and fixable disorder. It is not something that you John Wayne your way through. You can't just shut down and be tough and you know, bear it out. It will destroy you. And it doesn't have to. And there is help. And part of that help, and a really new and exciting part of that help, is the physiological help that comes with new medicines and new understanding of the brain chemistry. And if you'll come back next time, we'll be talking about that. Thank you very much.
Email your questions or comments to podcast@biobalancehealth.com. You can find the BioBalance HealthCast on iTunes and on YouTube. For more information about bioidentical hormone pellet therapy and other reverse aging solutions, visit biobalancehealth.com or call 314-993-0963. You can find Dr. Maupin on Twitter at Dr. Kathy Maupin and on Facebook at facebook.com/biobalancehealth. Find Brett Newcomb at brettnewcomb.com.